Good evening.
Good evening. I will apologize in advance for the fact that when little Sammy comes back to the back door, I'm going to have to get up and go let him in.
No worries.
Apparently, I'm on dog detail tonight. and there are three of them running around because my friend Cass, who you may well remember from several weeks ago, a show we did with Jeff Turner in Ann Arbor in her home, she has made the long trek down to Villarica, Georgia, to join us for Christmas. And we're all really excited about it. And she's crashed out and just like, she's down. It was a long, long ride through some hellacious weather. So, but I've got her Charlotte, her little Yorkie. And of course, Peanut Buttercup is here. And Sam, who is my mother and Christine's dog, who was actually April's dog.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And they inherited Sammy. So he's out in the backyard barking his head off right now. Nothing I can do about it. I'm the only one awake. So
no worries.
There's that. And I came up from Florida on Monday with my friend Aaron Bush that you had an opportunity to get to know.
Yes.
Out west last weekend. She flew in from Las Vegas, went home for about a half an hour, changed, packed up a few things, and hit the road and came and spent the night with me in Winter Garden. And then the next day we drove to Georgia and she stayed here with us for a couple of days, which was wild. it was wild. And we had a blast and it was great. And now she's safe and sound back down in Florida. But I wanted to thank her publicly for moving mountains to get me up here to be with my mother.
That's awesome. She, when we got to meet her face to face, wonderful woman, by the way, just fantastic. You said we'd love her when we met her, and we sure did. But she was saying, yeah, she flies back, and then the next day she gets up and drives with you to Georgia. That's just fantastic. Just fantastic.
Yeah, I'm very grateful. It's been a wonderful week. I've needed this desperately. But tonight, what we all need, and what I posted about earlier today, we need the pixie dust fairy sprinkles that accompany Maureen Hancock everywhere she goes. This woman's resume, I mean, you can spend 15 or 20 minutes just trying to absorb. Thank you, Jonathan. Just trying to absorb all that she does, everything that she is. And Erin, oh, you're so sweet. We've already got a wonderful crew on board. That's terrific. So I'm going to let Maureen tell you, I'm just not into reading resumes. I think that it's more important to spend our valuable time letting her just be her with the audience and talk about what she does. And oh, and there's Sammy. So bring her on in, say hello, and I'll be right back. I have to let Sammy in.
Okay, no, not a problem. How you doing, Maureen?
I'm doing great. I'm trying to get my heart going. So exciting.
It is. And we're thrilled to have you on tonight. We know it's going to be a great show. For audience members who are watching tonight who may not be familiar with you and your background, do you want to dive in a little bit and tell us how you got involved and what you've been up to and doing and all of the fantastic accomplishments you've been doing?
Stop it. So a little bit about me. I noticed that I, like many of you watching, noticed that I had an ability as a young child. And I call it an ability because we all have it, but so many children are open to the possibility and seeing spirits and sensing them, and they're not afraid because they just came in. So I was 2 years old when I went in Children's Hospital in Boston with lead paint poisoning. I was in a coma. I had brain shunts. I had acute encephalitis, and my parents were told that I would not survive. And then I spent 3 years in Children's Hospital. And when I came home, it was a true miracle that I survived. But when I came home from the hospital at 5 years old, I began to see spirits walking all around the house. And I'm sure we'll dive into that tonight with Andrea. And cut to 1992, I was in a horrible car accident, broke every bone in my face, had a near-death experience. And I started to hear the spirits. So very different from when I was young. I started working with police and FBI on missing people cases and murders and cold cases. And I also started a cancer foundation using my abilities with hands-on healing. I've been doing holistic healing work for 30 years. And back when, you know, people were like, what is Reiki? And I studied Chinese medicine and all that kind of stuff. So I love to help people who are at the end stages of life. So I'm sure we'll dive into that. And so there's just so much to the work that I do. And I'm so excited to be here with Andrea and to even learn more about what I feel in my heart is that missing piece of, you know, the UFOs and planets and the Pleiades, where we come from, right?
Yes.
And so that's a little bit about me. I wrote one book, The Medium Next Door. And I was a stand-up comedian in Boston. So I am known as the comedian medium. I use my abilities to bring through messages to help you find your purpose, live your purpose with no fear, knowing that, baby, you were born this way. Morticia. And Andrea, that's me in a nutshell.
Yeah, nut. Let's just focus on one particular carve out there. You're a nut. You make me laugh.
I'm a nut.
Oh my God. So I'm just cruising your page for a good laugh last week. And I come across you asking your husband, or your husband asking you if you'd like to watch 60 Minutes. And your response was, I don't know, how long is it?
That's the God's honest truth. Hold on. I have five chins. But I did. I was tired and no excuse, but he was like, do you want to watch 60 Minutes? And I was like, how long is it? For those of you that don't know, I'll sell you a vowel. 60 Minutes is an hour. 60 Minutes. Anyway. Yeah. And you'll have to go on my TikTok for some poops and giggles as well.
Oh, you know, I don't do TikTok because well, first of all, because everybody else is out there, I didn't want to get sucked into the vortex.
Oh,
everybody clones me on Instagram and TikTok and puts up all kinds of clips of different things that I've done. Like it's all fresh and new. And I'm like, you know, I don't have time to clean out that house, reestablish, you know, myself in that forum, you know, as authentically me. And try, you know, and kick the losers to the curb. So I just do Facebook and I leave it at that. And I'm really bad about taking care of that because I have so many other things going on. Well, you know, I mean, we spent our first, several hours together out in in Colorado at the Boulderado Hotel.
Yeah, the minute I met you, I felt like I've known you forever.
You know, it was so great. I'm like, I'm in such and such a room. I think it was 312. And you said, I'll be right there. And I'm in my jammies. And we just hung out and laughed and laughed and took pictures, selfies. And yeah, it's so good when you meet somebody. I mean, we've only known each other now for just a couple of months, really. And yet we've spent so much time together, have gotten into so much mischief already. I think it really bodes well for the future. That's what I think.
Oh, definitely. And everybody watching, you know, there's no coincidences. And I was introduced to Andrea by our good friend, Tiffany Rice. And the moment that I met you, and it was meant to be that we were both in Colorado at the same time for the same reason. And then 2 days later, Andrea was 5 minutes from my house in Middleborough, Mass. I'm in Bridgewater, Mass. And then we had dinner at our friend Lorna's house. And it's just like, wow, it's like great to see you after 10,000 years, Andrea.
I know. It's like, where have you been? And what took so long? What the hell took so long?
Oh, I was eating lead paint chips. They were like Necco wafers. And then I was in my car accident. You know, I had to go through some lifetimes and whatnot. And
some stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Satori Hawes is with us. I have to call you and tell you something about this young woman. She's extremely gifted. Wonderful. Jason Hawes' daughter. Oh, my God. She's incredible.
Wow. Mm. Oh, hello.
Going to have her on the show with her and Cody.
Thank you.
Oh, she's so sweet. She is so sweet. Oh, my God. I'd take her in a heartbeat. If I were to ever have a child, I would want it to be her. Would. She's that special. She really is. One of the things that I wanted to talk to you about is how, if you were reluctant to, I mean, when you finally came into an understanding of what you had experienced, how it had, I think you probably already had the second sight or the gift or, you know, whatever you want to call it, but that the traumatic experiences that you had seemed to unleash that. That said, one of the things that I've always wanted to know is, do you have, I don't want to say regrets, that's not the word that I'm looking for, any ambivalence about what you've been through in spite of what it gave you?
No. I mean, I should. And there's so much more to the story with different things going on with childhood trauma, like so many of us, and spending 3 years in children's hospital and having, you know, PTSD as a five-year-old and separation anxiety. And I still have that. So I just, you know, from the time I was five and my mother, God rest her soul, I know she's watching, would say to me, you know, what do you want to do, Moe? When, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I always said, I want to work with people dying. It was weird, you know, not weird, but as a five-year-old. And then in, you know, my teens, getting into all kinds of healing work, even though I was in the legal field and I was a paralegal and worked at Logan Airport and whatnot. But I just always knew it was my calling, that I needed to serve others and help. And the car accident was tough. And I still play guitar, but I played classical guitar and, you know, rock, everything. And then I had the car accident. I couldn't read music anymore. But I use my other senses. So I know I'm going a little bit off here. I have everything that ends in D, ADHD, ADD, OCD, yeah, sometimes ACDC. But anyway.
Rock on.
Yeah. But I started to listen, and I would listen to music and just copy because I couldn't read it anymore. But then with my mediumship abilities, I started to hear spirit. Right. So it would just come in that mind's voice that we all have. And because I had my fractured skull, everything was broken, fractured skull, nose, cheeks, jaw. I forgot to mention I was in a car accident. Oh, yeah, I did. And had a near death then. I felt my grandmother with me, and I yelled out, and it was her voice, and I shouldn't have survived. And I didn't need anything done. I mean, I had my face split down the middle. And so that was tough. And the only sort of drawback now to what I do is that there's not enough of me personally to go around when I get so many requests. And I do free readings for parents who just lost children. And then I'm helping to find missing adults and children every single day, every day, all over the world. So it's, I wish there was more of me. I do have to be careful, and all of you mediums out there or anybody doing energy work, with boundaries, take care of the vessel, make it the year of self-care coming up.
Oh God, that sounds like a lot of work.
But making time for you can be so healing. And like, I do 4 to 5 shows a week, events, and I'm cutting back to 2 a week. And I have to, because it is burnt. You can burn out the vessel, and I get energy work done. And then I have this darling here. Say hi. So I have 3 dogs, but you know, they're my healing grace, and my kids too. But mm-hmm. take care of you, everybody. Change your diet, go for walks. You have to do things to make sure that if you're here to serve, you have the energy to give to do so.
Again.
Did that make
sounds
you
exhausted? Sounds like a lot of work.
Yeah.
Sandy loves your dragonfly pendant.
Thank you.
It's very beautiful.
Thank you.
Suits you.
I was told to put it on. I had an amethyst, and I put this on and instead. So, Erin, one of my favorite ways to ground is I get shiatsu massage done every other week, and I'm a shiatsu practitioner. So I need touch. I need, you know, just grounding touch. But I also walk in the woods with the dogs every day, and I stand on the roots of my favorite tree, and I just can feel the heartbeat and the vibration from the tree. And I literally stand there like this, oh, hello, hello, trees. And they talk back to me. So I ground, and I picture the roots of a tree wrapping around my legs and gently grounding me to the earth energy. So I want you all to do that, so that when the wind blows, you can't be bowled over. You are grounded, flexible, and you can kind of blow in. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind.
Okay. Like a willow tree.
Yes.
Yes, they bend. They don't break.
And I love
their roots are shallow, but they're spread wide. They cover a great deal. They cover as much of the earth around them at the root system as they do at their widest part at full, when they're fully grown. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah. I'm going to borrow that one.
No, you can't have that.
I'm going to.
No, everybody knows that's mine. Everybody would, they would immediately say, uh-huh. You stole that from Annie.
Yeah, and I would say, I stole that from Annie. No, I have my own trees. Mine is the birch tree. The birch. You know,
yeah.
I have the a friend circle of birch. Have you ever
allergic
heard?
Allergic to birch.
Oh, you
allergic.
Are?
Lives in an area of the country where they're so plentiful that it's like practically the only kind of tree, and she can't get anywhere near them. Her whole body breaks out. Isn't that weird?
Yeah, because the circle of birch, if you all don't know, in like English and Irish and Welsh mystics would go, the women would go out in the woods and find a circle of birch and do their ceremonies and whatnot in the circle of birch and join together. And then my first house that I bought, everybody said, do you know that your house is surrounded in a circle of birch trees? I was like, yes, it is.
Mm-hmm.
Very powerful, everyone.
Yeah, it is very powerful. Well, you know, I really enjoy going outside, but a lot of what's involved is not only feeling the earth beneath my feet, but looking up into the sky and making contact with mm-hmm. my galactic family, our galactic family. And it's hard now because I have a little dinky dog who I need to keep an eye on when I have her outside, especially if she's off leash. But even when she's on leash, I have to keep an eye on her. And so I've noticed that I don't look up into the sky as much, and I have to figure out a way, some way, somehow, to be able to do that. Because that's where, in a strange way, that's when I feel most grounded. That's when I'm connected out there, is when I feel most here.
Oh, wow.
It doesn't make any sense at all. It seems utterly counterintuitive.
What do you think about this? Like, I'll look up, and I wonder if any of you watching can relate, and I feel sometimes like sad or like, oh, like, I want to go home, you know, or like, and I literally am like, hi, how you guys doing? Because I'm in hell.
Deb said I should have Peanut look up with me. Right. I know she's.
Do you have coyotes there? Because I just had 10 coyotes in my driveway when right when you brought me on, they were all hooting and hollering, and I was gonna open it up, so it was almost like, oh, she's here. I texted my husband. I'm like, don't let the dogs out.
Yeah, you don't want them tangling with coyotes. No, the last encounter that I had with coyotes, I was in Yucca Valley at the Joshua Tree National Park at a yurt. It was way out in the desert, and there was a big, big house, and then there were all little places around it. And I was in a yurt, and it was 4 o'clock in the morning, and it sounded like there had to have been a dozen of them right around this circular, good-sized yurt that I had. And they were howling and carrying on, and it sounded like they were right outside my door, right outside the door. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, me, I opened the door. I'm like, shut up, you know, go have a cuppa, you know what I mean? You guys are, I would have said it, but they wouldn't have understood. You know, and they went completely silent, absolutely silent. I didn't see one of them. Not one did I see. But the moon was almost full. It was a bright, bright night. And all of a sudden, and we'd been filming for like 24 hours. It had only been a couple of hours since everybody went to go lay down somewhere and relax because we were all exhausted. Here comes this perfectly round vessel across the entire sky. I can see the circumference of it, which seems to be lighted, you know, relatively well lighted, but I could see right through the center of the vessel so that I could see the stars on the other side of it. And I'm like, you know what? We were out here filming, you know, 2-3 hours ago. Would have been a really great time for you guys to come on through here and cut the sky in half this way and move, you know, move in such a way that it would have been really easy for us to film you. And, you know, I start bitching at them. Like, you know, this would have been really great if you knew we were here, what we were doing. Why weren't you here to do this then?
Yeah, day late, dollar short.
Well, you know, really, what's your cup say?
Psychic. Oh, okay. I forget.
I thought it said something else. Sorry.
You thought it said with an O on the end?
You know, no.
Oh.
No, even worse than that. No, even worse than that. I don't know. I obviously need to put my glasses on. My God. So anyway, yeah. And so as soon as I said that, it flashed. It just was like a ping of light, and then it was just gone. And then the coyotes started howling again, and they had gone away. But
because they saw
it was almost like the sensation that I got was it was almost like they had come to wake me up to go outside to see what I did.
Yeah,
that's what it felt like. Yeah.
Well, just like when you introduced me, I came on and then they showed up. I was like, that's interesting. Yeah. Energy. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I know. Oh, they're so wonderful. They are. They're so wonderful. I know people think, some people are really, I think more. There's a whole group of people that study UFOs. Julie DeMay is here. I know we should share some pics from Quincy. I should have done that. I forgot. Going up into Massachusetts, going up into your neck of the woods, being up there with Julie and being there with Lorna and doing an event at the theater, going to the Ocean State Paracon. you know, all of that was, it was my last big trip of the year. I had just come off of Colorado, as you know. It was absolutely blissful and delightful for me to be able to spend that time with you. And we made some fun film. As you might recall, we made some fun film.
Yes, people can watch that live Facebook. It's still on Maureen Hancock fan page. But that was awesome. Yeah, we have like 100,000 views.
I knew those, that was going to go viral. I knew it was.
Those are the best when you just be who you are, right?
I know. I know it. Yeah. Well, what did you love about doing comedy?
Ooh, so you know what? Stand-up comedy is harder than what I do now on stage with platform mediumship as the comedian medium. So comedian medium, it just comes natural. I just sort of like ad lib or I play off of something. So I get serious, but I feel that raising the vibration with laughter is how the spirits love to come to me. And I like to help it not be so overwhelming for people here. But comedy, like I would have to come up with new material based on what's going on in the world at this time. Or, you know, back when I started, I you could do things like Dumb Blonde. And, you know, I made fun of my best friend, Allison. She knows that. And so Allison was my skit. And she lived in Florida and she texted me and said, or maybe we didn't even have texting back then, but this was like early 90s. I'm going to be in town. I'm going to come to your show tonight at the Comedy Connection. And I was like, no, because she is my, you know, just everything. Like I would make fun of her. Like she saw this really happen, the Shell sign on the Shell gas station. And she goes, that's the most beautiful moon I've ever seen in my life. And like, I just couldn't take that away from her. But so she came and I was so nervous and I thought she was going to break up with me as a friend. And she goes, that was amazing. I'm going to be famous. And so that was all good. But it was hard to look out at people, especially a lot of guys in the audience, and they would heckle me. And I was back then like, just like, was I early 30s and just kind of shy. But I had that comedic side. And then I learned to have a thick skin that with comedy. And backstage, everybody would be, you know, doing lines, and that just wasn't me. I'd be sitting there with my M&Ms because, like, chocolate got me going. That was, you know, my thing.
Yeah.
And they didn't like me. It was very competitive. And so, you know, each comedian was sort of going against the other one. It was like we were all in competition. And so that was really hard. And then, you know, if you have a night that you kind of bomb, and it's energy, everybody, right? So it depends on how the group is feeling, you know, your audience, and how you're feeling. And you could tell when you're not really into it, and you know right now, it's, yeah, Pepper, right? So it's just, it's hard, you know, to make people laugh. Like, and then when I found I'd get the most laughs when I would go off script, like I had a whole thing of like, talk about Viagra, talk about politics, you know, whatever, talk about your husband, make fun of him. And then when people weren't laughing or they were heckling me, and then I was like, bam, 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 you know, that's when it came most natural. But to take that and bring it to the stage now, I feel very comfortable with what I do. And I never know what's going to come out funny. And sometimes the crowd is laughing more than they're crying. That's when you know you're having a good night.
Yeah. Yeah. That's when you're having a good night. Mm-hmm. Well, I just think that we should, you know, after people see our little ditty that we did, which I should have asked Tony to snag it and load it into the show tonight, or at least parts of it, because it's hysterical. But I thought afterward, I thought, you know, we should take this show on the road. You know, I mean, yeah. we were both in silly moods. Neither of us had had anything to drink other than water and apple cider. I don't know. You can't say it was something that we ate or we drank. We were just silly and we had fun and it was lighthearted and it was peaceful. And that's why I, you know, I said to people tonight, come and meet my beautiful Maureen, because, you know, here's the thing. We all need to laugh. I think there's something wonderfully healing about laughter. Truly wonderfully healing.
Yes. And so many people are so angry right now more than ever. They're just, you know, on the road, they're angry and at home and whatnot. And have you noticed that? So I really try to take it up a notch. I did an event last night and, you know, it was probably a sad crowd, a lot of newbies. I call them the spirit virgins. And I had to amp up the comedy. Because it was just like, and we have such loss right now that, you know, we're just losing so many around us that we love. And so just to bring that hope with laughter, and laughter is the best medicine, right?
It is. I think so too.
Yeah.
I think so too. Yeah. So we have to, Lorna wants us to do a thing at the Middleborough, at the theater. At her theater in Middleborough.
And she said the town hall is even better, because the Middleborough town hall, as many of you probably know, is super haunted. And I think even some of your followers have done some investigations there. I want to see some comments. And I went in there with a crew, a paranormal crew, and we got a lot of activity, a lot of voices. And giggles and, you know, a couple of get out, you know, but that doesn't scare me. I'm like, shut the hell up and give me a minute. Take your time and hurry up. That's what they said. But yeah, so that holds a lot of people, and the energy in there is just, you could just peel it back like lead paint. So we should do
just
the
middle. Just don't need it. Yeah.
Yeah. Lorna will bring us to the town hall. So that'll be great.
That will. Well, we have to wait till, you know, your frozen tundra has thawed out.
Yes.
Because, you know, I thought I would freeze to death while I was up there.
And Andrea.
Yeah.
We could do a VIP sleepover there. And have like just a group of, you know, some of your paranormal investigators and just regular folk that love it. And we'll do a sleepover almost, you know, when we get rid of the C word, but wouldn't that be fun? And just everybody has their equipment and we're just pulling an all-nighter and telling ghost stories and ooh.
Yeah, no, you know what's fun? A 4-star hotel with a jacuzzi.
I prefer 5-star, but whatever.
I'm okay with 4 or 5.
All I'm right, good. I'll Either sleep way. Over.
Actually, I'm okay with 2. I mean, as long as it's clean, it's got a bed, it's got a TV and a bathroom, I'm pretty good to go.
Me too. Same.
You know, low maintenance.
Yeah. I love, like, you travel a lot. I used to travel a lot, and it's going to start again. But yeah, same thing. I have my little snack pack, and as long as I just love to relax and watch the TV and just kind of space out, watch my Ancient Aliens and...
Do you love Ancient Aliens, do you?
You know, I like the show. I like a lot about history and about just everything from, you know, the pyramids to even like, you know, the history of Massachusetts and all the civil wars and this, that, and the other. So I prefer things that really happen as opposed to like fiction. I mean, nonfiction. I like nonfiction as opposed to fiction.
Yes. So do I. I think the world is interesting enough. We don't have to make shit up.
Oh my God. Yeah. It's true.
Well, yeah. So, you know, I would stay there and I don't really do a lot of investigating because I don't see the point. I'm looking for something I already know exists.
Oh my gosh. Exactly. For me, it's just more like, it's just, you know, shits and giggles, you know.
I know. I would rather just hang out with the people that are doing the investigating and, you know, just hang out and they can bring their evidence to me to review. That'll be fun. I do that.
I like that. Yeah. So I just did a piece on the Bridgewater Triangle. Have you heard? You know about it, right?
Oh, yes. Everybody does.
Oh, of course. So I went to, I was going to say King Richard's Fair, but I went to King Philip's Cave. Close enough.
It's different. Whatever. It's, well, you minus the turkey legs. Yeah.
And it's up. But, you know, I went to, sorry, King Philip, but I went to King Philip's Cave. And I'm going to be posting this soon because we created just a short little documentary. It's like 20 minutes long. But let me tell you, the in front of me is this huge, like this big purple orb that just kept floating around me. And of course, I was like, hi, is it okay if I'm here? You know, I respect the land and everything. And it was just pretty wild because, you know, I've had the normal size. It's just, it was just like amazing. And I just kept getting scenes. And then even behind some of the big rocks behind the King Philip's Cave, you know, you could see where there's definitely extraterrestrial activity, and you could just feel the energy. It was like zzz, like vibrating.
Yeah. Yeah. That's wild. The most fun. That's when it's the most exciting. Mm. Oh, Bridgewater Triangle documentary. Yes.
Jennifer, and I know there's a few of them, but yeah, Jennifer, thank you. Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, it's well, you know, that was one of the things that why we went out to Yucca Valley, because it's the area is known for so much activity that, and it's not just what's in the sky, it's the elemental activity on the ground. And it's bizarre. I mean, it really is bizarre. The Joshua trees, mm-hmm. I've never seen anything like them in my life, ever. They don't, they look like aliens. They don't look like they belong on Earth.
They're
all basically the same age. So where'd they come from? You know, where did they come from? They're all the same age, like hundreds and hundreds of years old. 500 wow. years old. I know. I know, it's bizarre. I mean, the more I read about them, although I have read some contradicting things about them, but they do actually reproduce, but they have to have a symbiotic relationship with a certain kind of moth. I know. So, you know, being out there and with there being, I mean, there were roadrunners everywhere and scorpions, I mean, big scorpions, not little ones, huge, enormous scorpions.
Like, can you give me a light?
Yeah. Truly. I know, it was bizarre. Spent 3 days out there, filming with Tony Rathman was with us and his wife Cherie. We had a wonderful time. Rick McCollum came with us and my friend Sheena Metal and a whole number of people, a whole bunch of different people, different producers. Jay Blemke was out there. Michael Mazzola was out there. Serena de Cameraman was out there, had come in from England. I mean, it was just a wild, wild trip. And the more I get to know you, the more I feel like you were the missing piece. And we should take you out when we finish the documentary. She wants to go to the Roswell crash site. I can't imagine going with anybody that would be more fun to do that with than you.
I'll start channeling them and like, talking in extraterrestrial languages. Oh yeah. Cause even when I channel somebody that doesn't speak English, I tend to say things in other languages and it's wild, mostly swear words, but still. Yeah, it's cause it's the language of love, right? So it all comes back to one. When were you out there, Andrea?
Oh God, when was I out there? Tony. When were we out in Yucca Valley?
That was back in June or July, I believe.
Did we go out there at the hottest time of the year? I thought it was May.
Oh, you're right. It was May. You are absolutely correct. It was May.
Yeah, and it was still like 117 degrees during the daytime.
It was warm, but we had that fantastic storm come through, which just was fantastic because of the way it came through. And then by night, the sky was clear. You could see all the stars. But yeah, you're right. That was May.
Excuse me.
It was wild. I got sunburned, and all I did was sit under a covering for 2 days, 3 days. The only time I was ever out in the sun was for like 2 minutes at a time to go back and forth over to, you know, one of the little prop sheds or, you know, what all the different stuff that they had set out there. And yeah, I came back sunburned. But wouldn't that be fun?
Like 20 watt light bulb, and I have a third degree burn. That's my.
So for any of your audience that's wondering what a Joshua tree looks like, here's a photo.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, that's a beautiful photo.
Wow.
Oh, Tony, you should send that to me.
Text that to me.
I'll download that.
Yeah, it's a beautiful photo. I mean, but it was no different where we were at. I mean, the same atmosphere, the same unbelievably magnificent skies with, you know, no city lights to affect it, and beautiful sunset with, you know, storm clouds on the other side. It was something.
It was. Yeah. And we have to go back because Serena said she wants to finish the documentary at Roswell.
Oh,
and
cool.
I just want to know which of the stores out there has the blow up doll that's the life size extraterrestrial.
Not sure, but I'll find out for you because those are popular, very popular.
I know. Google that for us. Okay, Tony, we'll all pitch in and get one and we'll share it.
Sounds great. I'll get that info for you.
Okay.
It sounds a little dirty if you ask me.
Well, see, but that's where your mind would immediately go now, isn't it? Isn't it?
Yes. Yes, queen.
And, you know, not for nothing, but I really think that you should start working on accentuating your Massachusetts accent so that people know, like when you're talking, people know where you're from. Like, you know, what part of the country you're from. Like, are you from the Boston area? Are you from, you know, Wakefield? Are you from New Bedford? You know, where are you from? I mean, you really should work on it, you know?
Yeah, because you
got some effort.
You just did New York, and then you went right down to New Bedford, right? Okay. So I grew up about a half hour south of Boston, near a Packy. But I spent a lot of time in Southie and Dorchester. Okay.
Southie and Dorchester.
So, and I worked at Logan Airport. So I was always at the airport. But I try so hard to lose my accent, but then I know I can feel when I'm tired, I go right into wicked awesome. Just get me a beer. You ho. You
do awesome.
Yeah.
Get me a beer, you ho. Get it. Just get it. It's in the fridge. Oh,
yeah.
My God.
And then I did, you know, I worked at Logan for so long, but I would leave my work at the airport and go over to Nick's Comedy Stop, to the Comedy Connection, Dick Doherty's, and I did a lot of open mics. And then I was new to it, but I guess I was a natural, and I got an audition for Saturday Night Live.
Oh, my God. I didn't know that. You didn't tell me that.
Yep. So it was at Caroline's in New York City, but I was pregnant with my first son, and then I started to have problems and had to go to the hospital and had to be off my feet for a bit. So I couldn't do the audition, but my life would have went a whole other way. I mean, you know, I would have been on Saturday Night Live, and it just would have all been comedy, and it just wasn't in the stars. I was supposed to, you know, do the work that I'm doing now. So, yeah. I was told to reel it in a little bit because I was you know, going to be on David Letterman show at one point. Mm-hmm. And, but they were like, you got to clean up your act. So I was Andrea Dice Clay a little bit.
Were you?
Because I had the tough, you know, Southie and Dorchester kids, and, you know, they're yelling and throwing shit. And, you know, I took them down. I took them down.
Well, you have to, you know, what are you going to do?
And now I have so many men that come to my events because of the comedy, because it makes it more accessible so that they're not as afraid of, you know, what lies beyond, and so many skeptical folks. And as long as they're a healthy skeptic, like, I recommend that. But to be a cynic, it's a little bit harder for me to get in. But I use the comedy as an ulterior motive to break that down the barriers, and to, when they laugh, ha, 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 their aura opens up and I'm in. I'm like, who's your daddy? That's what I do.
Is that what you do?
That's what I do.
That's a little scary.
What are you, wicked or scared?
I'm not wicked scared. It takes a lot to make me that scared.
It's us scared if you're from Boston.
I'm not. I'm not a scared at all.
Where do you get your New York accent from?
Stage training.
Really?
Yeah, I was a stage actor for, geez, 2 decades plus.
Yeah. So a lot of New York, give it to me.
Yeah. Oh yeah. What was it? Neil Simon, Come Blow Your Horn. I was the old lady, the grandmother, Mrs. Baker. Nobody could touch her. I mean, she was just mean as a snake, and a tough cookie. She was a tough cookie. And I had to, my hair was still black. My hair was still, they had to put gray spray paint in my hair for me to play Mrs. Baker. Wow. And now I can just do it.
You just went right into Baker.
Yeah.
I was in Oh, What a Tangled Web We Weave when I was 13, and I won a thespian award. I just want you to know.
Now that sounds like a dirty word.
Thespian? You haven't slept.
No, it's not. It's a lovely word. It's like the thespian lesbian. You're like the happy medium.
I am. But now, isn't it interesting, because you just brought up a great point that a lot of folks that I train and do intuitive work with, like, have done either theater or drama, or they were that different kid or went to the beat of their own drummer, and you've been in theater for years, and I taught theater for children, and just love it. So what do you think? Like, it maybe it helped us escape when I was younger, that helped me, like, get into character, and maybe I didn't have to deal with, you know, what was going on around me.
I would have to agree with that. Mm. For decades and decades of my life, I took great joy in being someone other than me.
Bam.
It was just so much easier to memorize who I was going to be on any given night on the stage, and know that role inside and out, not have to second guess anything, to get lost in the role, you know, just become whoever it was that I was playing.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't always achieve that. There were things sometimes, distractions that would happen. It would, you know, even if the audience didn't see it, it would just pull me out of character for a moment, or somebody else's missed line would kind of jar me back into realizing that I'm doing a play on a stage in front of an audience. But for the most part, once I stepped out on that stage, I was whatever character I was supposed to be playing and was absolutely true to her.
Yeah. And another thing I did, I don't know about some of you folks who are watching, but I would come out of my body. So I, you know, when I'd have difficult things, like even the dentist, but even like childhood stuff, I knew how to leave my body so that I couldn't or didn't have to experience it full on. And I would up and out like Shirley MacLaine. And I didn't realize I was, but I was like, wow, I can't feel my body and I feel like I'm up and out. And so I wonder if any of you, I want to see some comments, can relate to that, where you would just kind of leave, so to speak. Did you ever do that? You must have.
Yes. Yeah, pretty frequently. That's why I say, you know, I'm not really happy in 3D. It doesn't thrill me at all. I find it a very oppressive state of being, and all too often, very sad. A lot of grief, a lot of turmoil, conflict. It's just, it's not my happy place. Put that one back up again, Tony, please. It feels like a dizzy feeling. Yes, Jennifer, it does. Like your equilibrium is off, like the earth just shifted underneath your feet. Yes, it's like you start to float, you don't feel your body. And it is an out-of-body experience. Had to pull myself out of it sometimes. It's because it's comfortable. It's comfortable.
Probably
it's
uncomfortable. Uncomfortable. I think she meant uncomfortable.
Yeah. Yeah. See, it well, is scary. For me, it's very comfortable to be out of my body and off planet, even if it's for short periods of time. Yes, Deb, the fifth dimension is the place to be. Yes, it is.
Tell some of like folks that might follow me too that might not understand the fifth dimension of what that is. Like, this is third. So when we say like, oh, this is hell, and then we come up and out.
Oh, this is hell. Actually, this is the strangest, most bizarre conglomeration of heaven and hell that I can conceptualize, that it is both. That it is the darkness and it is the light. It is the good. It is the evil. It is the fear and loathing and hatred. It is the forgiveness and redemption and purity. It is everything, everything. And so, as Daryl said, when you move toward 5D, it feels utterly exhilarating and joyous. And I think it's the only place that we can capture that sensation of weightlessness on earth, and to capture the essence of the incredible lightness of our being. Maureen, it is not dangerous. It is a state of mind, a state of body, a state of being that is actually quite liberating. And it's not like having a near-death experience, not at all. There are physicists and, you know, people that study quantum mechanics that are absolutely certain that the world as we know it exists in multiple dimensions simultaneously, that multiple dimensions exist simultaneously. Which is why you in the paranormal, you will often hear references to interdimensional beings like Sasquatch. You know, why haven't we found a body? Because they come in, they go out. They come in, they go out. You know, maybe George Lucas was absolutely right about Chewbacca, and maybe Chewbacca's just another race from another planet that he was privy to. And created this, you know, incredibly endearing character in his films. I think that art imitates life and reality. I think that everything that exists in our minds exists someplace in the universe. And so when you escape three dimension, when you tune out, what about planet Earth and all that's happening on it, becomes silent and irrelevant for a few moments, and you can escape from this pressure cooker of influx of information and just free yourself and free your mind. It is, yes, it is astral projection. In some forms, yes, it is. It can also take the form of visitations. I do not call it abduction. That has an incredibly negative connotation to it. But we can, not only do we all hold the key, not only do we all hold the key to our self-imposed cage, but what we can do is reach through the cage with the key, turn around, unlock it, and free ourselves at any given moment. Aaron said 5D incorporates the feeling of interconnectedness to all things. 3D keeps us focused on the material, low vibrational emotions like anger, jealousy, etc. And she is absolutely right about that. Mm-hmm. So to liberate oneself from all of the emotions that are base emotions, that are negatively based emotions, particularly fear, that is, I think, the crux of the matter, is humans' ability to relinquish ourselves to fear, to like hand over our personal power, instead of understanding that our superpower is love, and that love is a verb, it's an action word, and that when we project ourselves out into the world and into the universe on that vibration, that frequency, that energy, we are literally, just simply by existing, we are helping to heal the world of its woes.
Wow. Yes.
That's all you got to say is yeah?
No, because I was reading, okay. I was reading Kate's comment. Because that, how can our minds create something from nothing?
It's not creating something from nothing. It's as real as the invisible air that we breathe to sustain our lungs and keep our bodies alive. Mm-hmm. It's as real as the new moon that you cannot spot in the sky, but you have no doubt that that orb is still there. I think there is a big difference between something existing or not existing than there is something which exists that is visible and tangible and something that exists that is not. And it doesn't mean that just because we don't perceive it in the conventional five sensory realm, that is the crux of 3D. Just because we don't sense it in this realm doesn't mean that it does not exist fully and completely, not only in this realm, but in other realms as well. And it is in the visiting of these other realms. As Deb says, there is no nothing. And Erin reminds me of what I've said 1,000 times, which is thoughts are things. Thoughts are things. Nothing in our physical world, nothing exists that was born of the creative energy of human beings that did not first begin as a thought prior to coming into tangible existence. Mm. So that thought was just as real as the chair that it created.
Wow, I love that.
Do you?
Yeah, and I always say to people or folks in that take my intuitive classes and whatnot, I'm like, and not only that, like where, okay, I can't see this, but it's oxygen and it's sustaining me and it's keeping me alive and it's filling me up, and it's same holds true with our spirit loved ones. And now you can take that, so many other avenues where it's still there. I just can't prove it to you or see it or whatnot. And then I say, and then you know, sometimes we have to use our imagination when we have them come in. You feel like you're making it up when you are, you know, talking to spirit and you're like, am I making this up? Is this real? And how do you differentiate between what is just your normal thoughts or and thoughts of energy and what is spirit energy, spirit body coming in and communicating with you, or even taking that further to, you know, the extraterrestrials communicating with you, you're not making it up. And oftentimes it will keep repeating until you get it, or it creates patterns of these are my signs and this is what I'm going to show you when I'm around, or this song's always going to come on, or you're always going to see that cardinal. And it just keeps repeating because in the three dimensions, like, we have to have these, like you said, tangible things. And when you go outside of that and come up and out, there's just so much more to explore, and there's never nothing. So there you go.
Well, it's like there's never nothing. Everything is one thing. I believe that's my only belief system, is that everything is one thing. Everything is energy. It's frequency. It's all, everything in existence is like one little filament of a vast tapestry that we can't see from one side of to the other. It's the whole universe. And, you know, we're tucked off in the back end of a galaxy, wondering if we're alone in the world and alone in the universe. And nothing could be further from the truth. And I get to know that. It really isn't about a belief system or having faith that they're there, or it's about my own experiences. Now, 50 years, I had my first conscious contact 50 years ago. You know, half a century is a long time to know something and to be very comfortable with it. And some people tease me and say, oh, you talk so matter-of-factly, so nonchalantly about it. You know, it's like, it's just a given. And I said, well, yes, because it's a given. We're not alone in the world. And part of this great awakening, this world awakening that we're going through, is coming to understand that it is in the realization of oneness that we share this existence, that there is no separation between us, that that's the illusion. And once we come to understand that everything is one thing, then we can make that quantum leap and out of the third dimension into the fourth and fifth and beyond, where we understand that energy is not created, nor is it destroyed. It simply is. In the same way, when people say, oh, well, you know, that's a bad thing and that's a good thing, and they have their post-it notes and their Sharpies and they write the word and they peel it off and they stick it on and they compartmentalize their lives. And what I think is the next logical question is, what if everything just is, and we're the ones that qualify it and quantify it and mark it and determine that it is either good or evil, right or wrong, darkness or light? What if it all is one thing? What if everything can only coexist in the presence of everything else? And when you start thinking about the world and the universe that way, a certain amount of judgment gets washed away with it. Because we are incredibly judgmental human beings. And, you know, myself among, I can be. But.
And fear, right? So we release judgment and fear, and then love is right in your face. And that is the goal.
Yeah. And that's the redemptive quality of it. And, you know, having reverence and respect for each other and also for ourselves. Now, I think, you know, coming full circle in the conversation, I think one of the reasons why I felt so comfortable playing someone else other than myself and so uncomfortable in my own skin as a youngster, feeling very much a misfit in this world, is because not only of what I was being exposed and some would even say overexposed to in terms of supernatural activity at the farm, which was new to me. I mean, I had never had any experience like that until we actually moved into the farm. And I was already 12 years old. So, you know, I knew that I'd had, when I had my first experience with extraterrestrials at the age of 13, my first conscious contact, I knew it wasn't my first contact. But with the spirits, I think that it was. And yet having that interaction is what opened me up to all the rest of it. I really feel like it was that pried wide open my third eye and made me realize that I see things that maybe other people don't. And yet I had the comfort of knowing that what I was experiencing, so was everyone else in my family, and I wasn't alone. So, you know, yes, there are still moments of PTSD and there are still moments of, you know, just feeling surreal in a moment, like this is not of this earth. This can't be happening. Why am I in the bubble? You know, when I have a spiritual experience, when I know that one thing I really think that people are interested in and I want to go back to with you is a question that we received earlier tonight. And that was about how you protect yourself from energy, the energy of others and the energy of what's coming in through you. How do you harness and direct that energy?
Yeah, and the interesting part is I didn't always know how to protect myself, or I was so open to the energies when this first started, and I'm sure a lot of you can relate that you just can't get enough of it, and you're a sponge, and you want to learn and grow and read and follow everyone, and it's just not even fast enough. When it's not fast enough, it's because it's already within you, and you're just awakening. But for me, it did cause panic attacks, extreme anxiety. I did not sleep at all. I just became wired with the energy because I had no idea. I didn't take any classes or get training. It just was happening to me. And I did a lot of hands-on healing. And I noticed when I put my hands on somebody else that grounded the energy. It was almost like, you know, when you finally ground your equipment or you have something new put in, but you need the electrician to come ground it. Otherwise, yes. I was just flailing all over the place, like some of you. And so, and I would get dark visitations and, you know, feel like somebody's like lying on top of me or, you know, a black sort of figure, half awake, half asleep. And the old me, it would happen night after night. And I wouldn't sleep because it was just constant. And I would pray and, you know, meditate and call everybody in. And it was very interesting that when my grandmother passed, she lived with us, head of the God Squad, squeezing the beads, Maggie Mack, that thing stopped hanging out or, like, you know, haunting me, whatever you want to call it. And then I learned to take fear and put it in the back seat, and I became stronger, and I became that I am in charge, and I flip the switch when I want, and I can't constantly be having spirits at the supermarket, the soccer field with my kids, all over the place, because some of you may be in this space where I was like, bring it, but I opened up too much, and it was a Lakota shaman who told me, Maureen, you're too open, you're allowing it all to come in. And then a couple of other energy workers said, I can feel, you know, some attachments. And now I don't allow that at all. But that is my intention. I am here to serve others. So I will do grounding work, get body work done. I'll get into the salt water. I was in the ocean here in Plymouth, Mass in November. I got in underneath. So, and I just, somebody mentioned about panic attacks and downloads. And so Andrea taught me that my panic attacks were in actuality downloads. What a difference that knowledge has made in my life. Awesome, Sandy.
So glad, Sandy.
Yeah, so, you know, make sure that you all have the tools in your medicine bag or toolbox to use. My number one thing was when I let fear go and I realized, no, I have control of this. It doesn't control me. So, and then I try to just eat right and ground with all kinds of different things. And it might be food, it might be supplements, it might be getting out into the earth, sitting in the grass, getting in the salt water, meditating, praying, walking, and clearing my mind. But after I do an event, I shower. So that's one of the ways too that if I have excess energy on, I'm gonna slough it off, just like the Japanese will rub your back with a broom, or others talk about, you know, sloughing off the energy. I know a lot of people will do sage and Palo Santo. That doesn't really do anything for me. I use my own energy to work with the energy and to release it as well.
I can't help it. There are times that I take on the energy of others to such an extent that I don't know how to shed it. I don't know how to clear it. I generally resort to just breathing through it. Just, you know, and yes, it can be like, it can come with some high pitched or some low, dull sounds, which are downloads. And I know that I'm being given help to deal with the influx of bombarding energy that I get through nobody's fault. It's no one's fault. You know, when you go to these big events and there's 1,000 or 1,500 people that are there and everybody wants to converse with you and everybody wants to share something with you and everyone wants to interact and feel that kinship and that closeness that we do when we get together. Not only are we generating a lot of energy to put out into this, you know, unified field of consciousness, but it can also be extremely draining as well. And there are times I come back and it's like, I have to sleep for 2 days. I just have to sleep for 2 days. Yes, downloads are messages and information that we get, at least that I get, and I know thousands of other people who have that experience as well, where you get fluctuations in tones that seem to come directly in to you through your ears, high pitch, medium, low vibration, sometimes long, sometimes short, always messages. And I don't know what they are. All I know is that when I'm lecturing, sometimes I'll be saying something that I did not think of before I actually said it. And I think that's when that information comes out. And I'm just being used as a conduit. Do you feel that way sometimes too?
Yeah.
You feel like you're just kind of the middleman?
Yes. The perfect analogy about a download. And when I'm making connections to spirit, a lot of times I won't remember after. So I'll see somebody the next day. This really happened at Burlington Coat Factory. And the one was like, hi,
I love Burlington Coat Factory.
And I said, hi. And she goes, you don't remember me? And I was like, I see a lot of people. She was like, it was last night. And so I always say, it's like I'm a court reporter. So it's not my case. So I am just there for the day. And then I leave. And it's not, I don't remember. If I have a really profound connection, yes, I'll remember it, but I do so many, and I read or connect for so many people at an event. Like, I am the Walmart of medium, so at a 2-hour event, I might do 50 to 60 connections. It's really unbelievable. And it's not like boom, boom, boom. I have just found a way to just give enough validation so that I can reach a lot of people. And I have learned to realize when I'm switching energies, that's always a big thing. And questions I get asked from a lot of my students, how do I know? Because you have more than one coming in. And now I've learned how to land the plane. Yeah. I've got the connection. I feel the quickening, which is the chills up and down your legs, your body. Mm-hmm. That's when the spirit has entered. My face will get flush. I make the connection. And then I can feel others coming in from the side. But then I finish, right? So your CERT method, you're getting characteristics, evidence, relaying the message, tying it all together. I learned that after I was already a working medium. And then I go on to the next. Boom, bang, boom, bang, boom. Boom, bang, boom, bang, boom. So, but yeah, I'll get the downloads like you, where at first it was all over the place, like I said, until I took the reins, right? And when I do come out on stage, if I've got nothing, and if you ever hear me say, everybody, oh, there's just so many voices. It's like the mall at Christmas time. That means I'm hearing crickets. And in my head, I'm like, help me, anybody, because it's just not, you know, always as strong as I want it to be. But guess what? When I take myself out of the scenario and I literally say, it's not me, it's them. And I say either Jesus take the wheel, or I'm just like, mom, dad, everyone, Buddha, you hear, you know, Red Owl, all my guides to come in. And when you take yourself out and you take ego out of the equation, it will flow better. I promise you. And I work with sick and dying children. So I have learned how to protect myself that way, because otherwise I would have a nervous breakdown. I have all these kids at Children's Hospital in Hasbro that I help and visit and help them. Little kids eating their cereal. Maureen, what's it like to be an angel? Am I going to be able to see my parents? Am I going to be little kids? They have helped me put everything in perspective, where all this bullshit, it just doesn't matter. We can honor our own journey and the challenges we have, but if you spend a day with me, you might just be more grateful and really look at your life differently. But I could cry all the way home. I could never come out of bed. And instead, I step out of it and I say, this was their soul agreement, or whatever they have set up for the learning and the growth and whatever everybody has to kind of go through in this earthly earth school existence, you know, before we keep growing and getting to the next level. But I teach so many parents about what you said, like, hey, there is no time in heaven. There's no past, present, future. It's all one. And we are still here together. And it's just amazing when I can help them to see, you know, we're not dead. We're just different. My nephew said that to me when he physically died at 19. His part of his car fell on him. And he said, Auntie, I'm not dead. I'm just different. And I have carried that ever since 2004.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. It's
Red Owl is the guide for me. That's what my Lakota shaman told me.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Tony, could you come back in for a moment?
You bet. Hello. I can.
Hello, darling. Hello. I have three dogs that are telling me that they must go out right now. So entertain my sweet Maureen for a few minutes and let me break away. I'm sorry. I'm the only one up. I have dogs at the door.
Just no apologies needed. And okay. I've been monitoring the questions. So Maureen, one of the things that the audience keeps coming up is they were asking, and I know that you do, but I'm just going to repeat their questions, but they're asking, do you communicate with spirits, and how did that begin, and how do you handle that today?
Thank you. So you know, it began as a child with my lead paint poisoning. I was in a coma for a while, and I went into the hospital at 2 years old. I spent about a year straight, but in and out for several months for two more years. And I started to see spirits. I didn't know they were spirits when I was young, walking around the house. And I asked, you know, I'm one of nine, so I thought we were just having parties because my parents had a lot of parties, Irish, you know, Catholic. We're having a ball, a high ball, and the old fashions. And so I said to my sister, who are all these people? And she was like, shut up. They're going to take you back to the hospital. But they were spirits. I put this in my book, The Medium Next Door, that they look like Puritans or pilgrims or whatnot. And they would always change. But that was a lot of those visitations were people in old fashioned clothing. And then they would surround my bed. It was scary as a 5 year old. I used to have dogs barking, and they were like, and I'm an animal person. I train dogs and I studied small animal science and I was a vet tech, but I'd have dogs around my bed and I couldn't get out of bed, and they'd be like barking, almost like you see the, you know, the dogs of hell or whatever it was. And, right. And then my parents just thought it was all the medication I was on for the lead paint. And then cut to 1992, I'm in that car accident, had a near death. And then I started to hear the spirits. So I don't feel that you have to hit a tree or get in an accident for you to open up that portal so that you can connect or use, you know, so much more of whatever it is, your brain and your heart and feeling energy and understanding energy and using your abilities, because we were all born with the ability to see, feel, hear, sense, even smell spirit loved ones. And it's for our survival. Excuse me.
True.
But anyway, so that's
what I'm curious, though, because of the number of documented cases where somebody has had a near-death experience, and one of the outcomes from that experience is a very increased sensitivity and exposure to spirits, to knowing what's going on. I know I have my own theory about why that occurs, but do you have a personal theory as to why an instant like that of a near-death experience would open those doors and windows further?
Yeah, and I've heard that multiple times as well. And for me personally, and I'd love to get your take on it, I just feel like, you know, you sort of open up that portal that is available to everyone, but I traveled it and came back. And then right. It's almost like a clear pathway so that I am not clouded with feelings of, you know, guilt and anger and all the heavy emotional stuff here. Because when I went over there, it was pure love. And I have helped thousands of people pass with my hospice work. And so many have just gone like, oh, it's beautiful. It's amazing. And they're in this like ecstasy. So I just feel like we've accessed this portal, this part that is accessible to everybody, but right. Actually was there. How about you? What do you think?
Well, my personal opinion is that, you know, when you first start out life, it's always the younger kids, the children who see things, who experience things. And because they're the closest, they've only been around, you know, maybe 5-6 years. So that connection still holds true until yeah. Parents or relatives or life pulls that information away from them, distracts them yeah. from it. And I think a near-death experience reconnects to what you knew in the beginning. And, you know, people always say, you know, what does the human body run on? Well, it runs on two things. The physical body itself runs on food, nutrition, but there's another source. If you were tired, literally, if it was just food intake, you could eat a whole pizza or a couple of hamburgers and you shouldn't be tired anymore, but you still are, because there's another source that needs to be recharged. That's the spirit. And I think when that a near death, that spirit gets re-exposed to the environment it came from and opens up some of those abilities that people who have had a near-death experience all of a sudden say, you know, I can hear spirits. I can see them now. I can, I've got all these abilities I didn't have before.
Yeah, makes total sense. And I love that. And I'm going to actually add that to my explanation of, you know, you went home and you came back, you went home, you came back. And it's a clear pathway again. Right. But you're as like you said, children, and I've noticed 2 to 3 years old, they start to see spirits. And like you said, and even dogs and cats, like they haven't been like jaded like us, or we question everything. So little kids lead with their heart because they don't know any other way. And 5, 6 years old, they feel funny. They feel like with their peers, like, oh, this is different. I'm different. And when they finally realize that, and then, you know, normal, like all of us, ego comes in, which can bring fear and all those other like lower vibration feelings that are normal. But yeah.
Cody is with us. Cody and Satori have developed a system for communicating directly with spirit, which I find to be the most uplifting, most inspiring experience that I have had in the paranormal field since the inception. Not just since I wrote the books, but of everything that I've experienced in my lifetime, these two youngsters have found a way to communicate directly with spirit in a way that is, I'm awestruck by it. It makes obsolete the spirit box.
Yeah.
I don't know if it can be duplicated or not with other individuals, but it is, we are at a time, this is, you know, the paradigm shift. I call it holy shift. Well, when I saw what Cody and Satori do together, that was a holy shift moment for me.
Yeah.
And I think that it will bring, ultimately, it will bring great comfort to people, especially in these times when, you know, you look at the news and it says we've lost 800,000 plus. We've lost way more than 800,000 people to this virus. It's just that a lot of the deaths were never attributed to COVID. People that died at home, people that died a sudden onset of a heart attack. It is a time of great loss and great sadness in the course of human evolution and our history. And to know that we can be in touch and communicate directly with the other side, which I don't think that there really is an other side. I don't think that there is a veil per se, that it is, it's part of our indoctrination. It's part of the conjured up machination of humanity thinking, you know, that we're here in our little egg and everything else around it is, doesn't have any bearing on our existence, when exactly the opposite is true. So, you know, I refer to Earth as soul school. And the thing that's the most irritating about being in soul school is that the test always precedes the lesson. It doesn't work in the reverse. So even if you're sitting at the head of the class with all your great gifts and your talents and a self-awareness of your abilities, and you're still sitting there with your hand raised, like, pick me, you know, I know the answer. No, we don't. I think that realization of oneness includes an understanding that we don't know the answers, that the history of human evolution and the mystery of life itself is something that functions as jet fuel for our consciousness to keep us ever curious and fascinated and searching ahead, searching further. And what Cody and Satori have done, I'm going to have them on the show in a few weeks when we get through the holidays, to talk about not only the future of the field, but the validation, the confirmation of what they're doing, present tense, is extraordinarily important and will lead the way for many, many others to experiment in their own right. It was, if I recall properly, this just came to them in the same way that what I do out under the stars with, you know, hundreds of people, introducing them to the galactic family. That was not a preconceived thing. That happened spontaneously. It did. Yeah. And I have learned over the years how to not perfect it. There's no perfecting it. The ball is always in their court, always. They decide who's ready to see them, what kind of contact it will be, in what measure, at what velocity. You know, are we traveling together at light speed tonight, kids? Or are we in slow motion, you know, to get everybody's attention? The thing is that what you do, what Tony does, what I do, and what countless others do in the field was just taken up a whole nother notch with Cody and Satori's work. Yep. And it validates everything of all that we're doing, of everything that we're doing. How spirit communicates with you, Maureen, is different than the way that spirit communicates with Cody and Satori. It doesn't make it any less valid. Mm. It's just different.
Like, and clearer, or like, what is it? Is it a their way of connecting, or did they create something? Like, I'm so curious.
They just connect with each other. They hold on to each other physically, and they ask questions, and this tapping comes in. They're literally and figuratively tapping into the unified field of consciousness. Mm-hmm. And can, just by using the alphabet and the tapping, the yes, the no, the answers, they ask the questions get answered. Some questions don't get answered,
right?
Because spirit cannot divulge certain things to us. But they just physically connect with each other, and they hold on, and the tapping starts, and it sounds like it's coming from everywhere. Like it's in the air, it's in the floor, it's in the walls, it's coming from the ceiling. It's like everywhere. It's clearly audible. And Satori asks the questions of the spirit that is trying to communicate with them. And a few months ago, they connected with a man who had just died a couple of months prior. And he came through and he spelled out his name. And meanwhile, Ken DaCosta is looking up his obituary. And he said his full name and the day that he died, and that his wife's name was Margaret, and to tell her that he loves her. Yep. Now, I can't think of anything more important than this. To know that we are not alone, that spirit becomes essentially extraterrestrial in the passage of the vessel and the dying of the vessel comes the new life in spirit. What more important questions are there for human beings to ask than who are we, where do we come from, why are we here, and where are we going?
Mm. Right. Everybody asks, you know, what is my purpose? And especially after losing a loved one, why did they go and I'm still here? What am I supposed to be doing? And how can I find that path? And I love what they've created too. And I just got chills, you know, when you were talking about it. And just like you said, like, they're not like, so many go, where are you? And they're like, I'm right here. So they really are right here all around us. Mm-hmm. And it's just almost like, you know, hello, like I'm being born again into this energy or understanding it better, right?
Yeah.
So true. And you know, the other amazing thing about what Cody and Satori do is we were talking earlier about, you know, kids will have experiences, but life usually pulls those experiences away. Well, if you look at Cody and Satori, I mean, they're in their early 20s, but look at how their childhood and how they grew up. I mean, Satori, daughter of Jason. I mean, so I'm sure he was not any negativity as far as connecting or communicating. Cody, on the other hand, had an interest at an extremely young age. And our good friend Ken DaCosta allowed him in, taught him, trained him. And so those experiences, again, what we were talking about before is that they were never sidetracked from what they thought or felt or were experiencing. They were encouraged to increase it. Then you put the two together, and we had them on our show 2-3 weeks ago. And it was really funny because when they said when they connect, Satori said she'd get a headache, and Cody said he'd get like shin splints. His shins would hurt. And we were thinking about that, and it's like they almost connect as a circuit, and then that energy travels, you know, from her and then out him, which would explain the feelings that they're saying when they do it long enough, they both have and experience. So that was interesting.
That's wild, because I will feel the quickening and the chills go up and down my legs and shins. And then after an event and I'm doing so many connections, I have to massage almost like get it moving again in my legs, mm-hmm. and my calves. And even just here, I'm just doing like my point work. And so that's really wild. And so many get, you know, the energy headache too, when an influx of energy in it, when it's really, really powerful, you know, my face gets red because of the energy rising, and it's all right here. And I do have to like raise it up from my crown chakra and then open so that it can just has a place to kind of go out. And when I get energy work done, they say, Maureen, all your upper chakras are just too open and buzzing, and you need to focus on your root chakra and, you know, your navel chakra and solar plexus, because, you know, it's almost like, and then up here is just constantly open. So trying to get that happy medium, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I hear you. Well, and, you know, and it is difficult to strike that balance. I know that when I have a direct connection, whether it's just for a few moments or if it's a longer experience, I have an absolutely visceral reaction to it. It is, I mean, I willingly leave 3D at every opportunity. It's the only way that I can bear to be here, is to be able to escape it whenever I want. And that can happen over a 10-minute period sitting out on my mother's back deck, watching the dogs play and having a cigarette and watching the leaves fall out of the trees and just being lost and gone. And that 10 minutes is... could have been 10 hours. It could have been 10 days, time, the sensory perception of time literally disappears. And I don't know where I go, and I don't know why I go where I go. All I know is that it gives me a chance to come out of the heaviness for a little while, just a little while. And I think that part of that is in the old religious tradition, what is known as practicing the presence, practicing, you know, just being in the present moment, just settling into the now and letting yourself be free of what encumbers us. Free of pain, free of worry, free of trouble, free of fear, just free for those few moments where we feel peacefulness inside of us. And I think that it would behoove all of us to strive for that sensory interaction more, that part of us that literally goes within and makes contact, direct contact with the source energy that created us. And having those moments of stillness can be literally what lifts you up and out of despair, can literally be what lifts you up and out of a grief so deep that you don't think that you can breathe anymore. I've done a lot of counseling in the last couple of years, a lot. And I was trained as a grief counselor 25 years ago at the school where I worked. They chose me out of the entire staff of more than 300 people to work with clinicians and therapists and learn what I needed to learn to work with children who had suffered trauma. Not ever realizing that a quarter of a century later, that those skills that were ingrained in me, embedded within me at that time of my life, would be in such high demand for an entirely different reason, you know, and that is for being able to reach out and touch the ones that we've loved and that many of whom we've lost in extreme sadness, where they were alone and could not have anyone with them as they perished. Okay. That's the ultimate irony and cruelty of this particular virus, is that so many people have had to die alone. And I know that that affects you, Maureen, because you've made it, you know, part of your mission to help others make that transition in a peaceful way where they don't feel alone.
Right. And when I have been working with hospice for years, the same thing. And but like you said, someone's talking, but I know that when they die alone, they're surrounded with their loved ones who've gone before them. You know that. Yes. But I've witnessed that so many times where they're like, oh, look at, you know, there's my husband or there's my child. And even when my grandmother passed, she couldn't talk for 2 months. She had a stroke. The moment that she was coming out of her physical body, 2 months not speaking, she just went, oh, and she just said, Pat, it's my son, Pat. And she could see her son who died in the Korean War. And she started talking. And then she grabbed me and she was like, can you see her? The Blessed Mother. And I was like, where? So she just was returned to wholeness in that moment. And I've just witnessed that so many times. So especially through COVID, even though they're alone and even if they're out of it and you're FaceTiming or the nurses let you call them and they can't answer you, I have proven that they hear everything that you said or talked about, very specific, not just the usual kind of stuff. And so they are aware and they're not afraid, even though it seems like they are. And then it's just magnificence when they come out of that physical body suffering. So
yes. Well, I think that the real suffering, Jolene, advice on what to do for a 7-year-old who's experiencing things. Well, let me finish this thought first. The difficulty is always not for the one who has passed, but for the ones that are left behind. Mm-hmm. And we're the ones that are tortured by the idea that a loved one has perished without a hand to hold. When you're right, they're already completely surrounded. But I think that we're all completely surrounded by spirit all the time of our loved ones and those who watch over us and our guides. And as for Jolene's question, you know, this has been an ongoing issue for a while. A 7-year-old child who's having a multitude of experiences and doesn't know how to talk about it, how to communicate about it, is really struggling. So if you have anything to offer, Maureen, I'm sure it would be greatly appreciated.
Yeah, and I have so many parents reach out to me over the years asking that same question with, you know, my 3-year-old, 5, 6, 7. And to have a 7-year-old who's still sort of sensitive and feeling things, my gut feeling with him is he is an empath. An empath feels things very deeply and is super sensitive. And my son at 7 years old was saying to me, like, you know, who's that guy looking at me from the closet? And, you know, what does he look like? He has like a black cloak and red eyes. I was like, I don't think so. And get out all my stuff. So to help your 7-year-old, you would start by validating his experience and listening to him, not taking it away. And I know you don't. And then I did this for my son where I said, well, here are some things you can use to help when that is happening. You can either tell them to go away and do it with confidence, no fear. And I taught him Saint Michael the Archangel, stand at every door and window. That's what worked for us. And for him, you know, to explain to me what was happening. And then I worked with him in the room and I would talk to the other beings, or, you know, you need to let him sleep. You need to leave here. You know, this isn't comfortable for him. And if it is comfortable for him, say like a papa is talking to him, acknowledge him, say, yes, papa is talking to you. He's your guardian angel. And having conversations, there's some great books for our kids who are sensitive, who are empaths, kids that can feel things and that are expressing that. And then there are counselors too that can help, that are open to spirit communication. And I used to send everyone to Jill Sylvester, Hanover, Mass. I don't know if she still does, but she specializes in gifted children. She's a medium and she is a child psychologist. And so she knew how to marry the two to help children. So he'll be okay. Just always validate him and then help him to have tools that he is in charge, not the spirits and the feelings. And so that it doesn't turn into anxiety, because that's what it did to me, because I didn't have any help. I stifled it. I wouldn't tell anyone about it. And I felt alone. And that started my path to going in the woods and, you know, not like the other kids. I was reading Aliens Among Us at 9 instead of, are you there, God? It's me, Margaret.
Yeah. Yeah. Aliens Among Us rocks. Yeah.
Yeah, as a young kid reading that and being, am I a woman?
I didn't really have a whole lot to choose from. You know, being born in 1958, by the early 70s, there really wasn't that much stuff out there about what I was experiencing. And so, being someone who was constantly seeking out resource material and a voracious reader, it was a little disconcerting to find that I didn't have any information, you know, to fall back on. So that can make you feel very much like, you know, you're on your own here, kid. You know, you're on your own.
What's happening to me?
Exactly. Exactly. Well, I want people to know that they can reach out to you. And I can't believe 2 hours has gone by as fast as it did. It's just so, so wonderful to have you on board. I think we touched on some important subject matter tonight. And did so with humor and grace, which you know, is you. That's you. And I'm so looking forward to being with you again once your frozen tundra has thawed and I can tolerate going back up into southern New England. But we will we'll do this again, my dear. And thank so you. Let people know, we only have a couple of minutes left, so I just want you to let people know how they can reach out to you and connect with you.
So I have a few ways. Maureen Hancock fan page on Facebook. I did not start that myself. Years ago, someone else did. It wasn't like, I need fans. So that's Facebook. Instagram is Medium Maureen Hancock. Twitter, Maureen Hancock. I am on TikTok, Maureen Hancock. And then my website is maureenhancock.com. This is my book, The Medium Next Door, Adventures of a Real Life Ghost Whisperer. At the end of every chapter is ways that you can sort of hone your skills. And I have the Maureen Hancock University, which is an online school for all things soul and spirit related. I go live once a month, an hour and a half. And that is my information. And through the website, you can email me. I don't do private readings because I work with mostly children who are end-stage cancer and the police and FBI on cases. But I do events called Postcards from Heaven. And that's with the comedian Medium. Medium Next Door Live. Yeah.
Thank you
for having me.
You are adorable and delightful. And it is lovely to welcome you into my circle of friends on A World Awakening. We have the best audience, the most incredible viewers. I love them all. And now they love you. So the circle just expanded.
Wow. Thank you. And then my folks that are watching and just being introduced to all that you have to offer. And I can't get enough of it. And I want to learn so much more and grow with you. So I'm excited for our reunion.
Yes. Our reunion. Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank
you. Well, I want to thank all of our viewers for joining us tonight on A World Awakening. It's always my pleasure to bring the best and the brightest in this field into your living room or your office, your man cave, your computer, your TV, your home every Friday night. Next Friday night, we'll be doing a rerun of Last Christmas Eve, where I rewrote the night before Christmas. And it had nothing to do with Santa Claus, but instead with extraterrestrials landing on the roof. So I hope you enjoy my rewrite of a famous old poem. And we'll keep you posted about what's happening on New Year's. But I do believe it's going to be Rerunville, and you shouldn't be up doing anything but watching the ball drop in Times Square. So have a lovely evening, all of you. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Tony. Thank you to Bill. And the message for tonight from above is dare to believe. There is reason to have faith. Expect a miracle. Good night.
Yeah.